Have you ever seen a shootout before in an old black and white movie? Now, people are getting shot, but there's always something wrong with these shootings. There's no blood. We see gunfire, but we never see the impact of the bullet as it tears through the skin and causes bleeding. Now, these old black and white crime films were violent, but they were never too violent. All that would change in 1967. With a movie called Bonnie and Clyde.
Well, I'm Miss Bonnie Parker, and this here's Mr. Clyde Barrow. We rob banks.
Now, this brutal and bloody film about a pair of legendary criminals isn't just another fast-paced crime film. Bonnie and Clyde helped inaugurate a new, more socially engaged era in Hollywood filmmaking, and it forever changed how the movies depicted violence and sexuality. Now, how does the film do all this? Well, just give me a few minutes of your time, and let's go back and take a closer look at Bonnie and Clyde. One of the things I like about this film is how they always make Bonnie and Clyde feel like real people. They're killers, and now they're legends. But here they're just teenagers, and the film goes through great lengths to prove just how doomed, just how vulnerable they are. And that really grounds the film and makes the characters seem human and vulnerable even as they commit their crimes. Take, for example, the role that sex and sexual frustration plays in the film's main relationship. When Bonnie first meets Clyde, he shows her his gun, and she is impressed with the size of his gun and even begins to stroke it and admire it. She admires Clyde because he seems so potent. But later it's revealed that his character is actually impotent and unwilling or unable to have sex with Bonnie. So as the film goes on, Bonnie wants desperately Clyde to claim his manhood with her, and his unwillingness to do so leads to tension throughout the entirety of the film. But it's important because the couple is unable to get off physically. The two seek pleasure elsewhere. They seek pleasure through the thrill of crime. It is these criminal acts, rather than the sexual acts, that even end up creating the pseudo-family that surrounds Bonnie and Clyde, as more and more people are drawn to the freedom they seem to represent. So the crimes in Bonnie and Clyde and the relationship between the two is motivated just as much by genuine sexual frustration as it is by money and thrills. Now, even though this film takes place in the 1930s, Bonnie and Clyde is very much a product of the 1960s. In fact, the film is encoded with some of the counterculture, anti-establishment spirit of the 1960s. We should remember at the time of the film's release, 1967, it was a very turbulent time in American history. There was a violent war underway in Vietnam, and there were protests and riots in the streets, all fighting against this war. So in this film, we can see some of these counterculture themes of youthful protest, individuals against the system, and the thrill of an unconventional lifestyle. Also, we see the implicit justification of violence against institutions, like banks and law enforcement. We can see this demonstrated in one key scene where Bonnie and Clyde encourage a man who's just had his house foreclosed on by the bank to shoot his old property. Now, what should be noted at the time of the film's release in 1967, television was bringing home the reality of the violence of the Vietnam War to the American people. At the time, you could turn on your TV and see shootouts and soldiers dying right in front of you. So Bonnie and Clyde captures his newfound reality of violence and bloodshed in the film's graphic final sequence, where Bonnie and Clyde's murder at the hands of the police is shown in graphic detail. Bonnie and Clyde may have come out more than 40 years ago, but I think it's still a smart, entertaining movie about American violence, and I encourage anyone remotely interested in film to go out and see it. Thanks for listening. Please post comments below, subscribe to my channel, and share this video.